Hello everyone. So today we will be doing the second part of module 5, that is centrifugal pump. Well, centrifugal pump we have seen in our daily life, you know, it's there in all the houses. Whatever pump we use for lifting water to the overhead tank, that is your centrifugal pump. And it is such a good pump that even if you have sewage water or slurry water, even that can be lifted up, and it's also used in fire stations. Okay. So today we'll be discussing the parts and working a little on the heads of your centrifugal turbine, and we'll just draw the velocity triangle. Okay, the next class I'll be taking the work done calculation. So coming to the parts of the centrifugal pump, well, the main parts are impeller, casing — there are three types of casing — suction pipe with a foot valve and strainer, and delivery pipe. Now in your turbine we had a runner. Now, instead of a runner, we have an impeller here, okay? Equivalent to, if you compare your turbine and your pump, your turbine, the central portion is called as a runner, whereas in case of your pump, it is called as an impeller. There are three types of casing: volute casing, vortex casing, and casing with guide blade angles. Suction pipe, it generally connects from the bottom. The pipe connecting from your, you know, bottom of the tank to your pump, and your delivery pipe from the pump to the pipe connecting from the pump to your overhead tank. Okay. Now coming to it, so this we have seen, you know, it's a very common, you know, it's a very common centrifugal pump, and a pump, lot of places colloquially it is also called as motor. Okay, so your motor is an attachment to the pump. Now, in this is the motor part, and this is your pump portion. Okay, so since it's attached, people say it's pump and motor, both colloquially are the same, but if you come to actual engineering, it's different. Your motor converts your electrical energy to mechanical energy, whereas your pump, which is this portion, is converting your mechanical energy into your water energy, or water power, from mechanical power to your water power. Now I had discussed about three types of casing. These are the three types of casing. In one look, all looks the same. So coming to the first casing, that is a volute casing. The volute casing. Now in this casing, so before I go to the casing, I'll just tell you what is an impeller. Now, but impeller, it looks almost the same as your runner. It has got vanes. These are called as backward vanes. And remember, in a pump, the water comes from the center and then it flows out. Okay, and it flows out and then it goes up. So it's a reverse of your turbine. From the center, it is just flowing out. And these are all called as backward curved vanes. Okay. It is connected to a series of backward curved vanes, and these vanes are attached to your, this central portion is attached to your shaft. Now next, your casing. I told you there are three types of casing. Now in this casing, you can see the area is gradually increasing. So this gradually increasing casing is called as a volute casing. Okay, now since the area is gradually increasing, your velocity reduces, and the reduction in velocity is converted into pressure. So it's able to create pressure, and the velocity, the efficiency because of that is good. Okay, slightly good. Now the improvisation of that is your vortex casing. Now vortex casing is, you have your normal casing. Inside that, you are introducing one more casing inside. Now what happens is, like, now once the one, as I switch on the motor, the water is coming here, it is going through here, it is having a casing here, so there is no flow in the outer direction. It flows out and it comes up. Okay, so from here, instead of the huge space, the casing is there, it prevents the flow of water, too much of water on the outside, and then it is getting lifted up. So compared to your volute casing, your vortex casing has a better efficiency. Okay, and now coming to the third type, that is your casing with guide blade angles. It is also called as diffuser ring casing, where as the water comes out of your, you know, central portion of the impeller, it is coming out, it is having guide vanes, which is guiding the water to flow upstairs. So this also has a good efficiency. So here, your guide vanes, as the guide vanes you have in your turbine also. Here also it is guiding the water to go out, flow out in a regular pattern. And it is attached to your, it is coming after your impeller. So since it's guiding, it has a better efficiency. There's got two names. One is your diffuser ring casing. The other is casing with guide vanes. So these are your three types of casing: volute casing, vortex casing, and diffuser ring casing. Now it all depends on the head of your turbine, which one you can use. All three are equally used in your normal cases. Now this is the overall picture of your centrifugal pump. So whenever I'm drawing the centrifugal pump, this portion is the most important one. It has got the impeller. This central portion is called as the eye of the impeller, impeller blades, casing. This pipe, which connects your bottom tank to your pump, is called as your suction pipe. Okay, this pipe which connects is called as your suction pipe. And from here to your outlet, okay, to the outlet, which is at the higher level, that pipe is called as your delivery pipe. Okay, now this pipe is your suction pipe, and this head from the center line to the water surface is called as your suction head. Okay, important term in centrifugal pump. So suction head is nothing but from the center of your pump, that is the eye of the impeller, to your water surface in the below tank, that is called as my suction head. And here this is my delivery pipe. So the distance between both are your vertical distance. Okay, so the distance between the center line of the pump or your eye of the impeller to your water level or the top of the overhead tank, that is called as your delivery head. Remember, during the operation of your pump, HS and HD will be varying because your level of waters will be changing. Now you have your flange here. Your flange is nothing to connect two pipes, okay? Two pipes or two parts of the pipe, etc. So you have a suction flange, your delivery flange. It is not an important thing. You can miss out it out also. It's not an important part of diagram here. My important parts are here are impeller, casing, your delivery pipe, and your suction pipe. Now generally suction pipe, we have it, generally the water at the bottom will be having a lot of particles. So we are providing a strainer. Okay, generally if you suppose you have, a groundwater or something, you all mostly provide a strainer over here so that the particles are not getting lifted up. If the particles enter, what happens is like your impellers get damaged fast. So you have a strainer and you have a foot wall. Your foot wall is a one-way wall. It only allows water in the upward direction. Okay, so it's a one-way valve which is generally provided in your pump. And sometimes you have a submersible pump also. Your submersible pumps are kept here at the bottom. Okay, suppose the pressure created by the pump, centrifugal pump, is not enough. We have one more pump here, which is called as the submersible pump, which is not there in your syllabus. But just for information, I told you. So this picture is very important. And as I told you, the main parts are impeller, with your backward curved radial vanes, the casing, your suction pipe, as well as your delivery pipe. And whenever you draw the diagram, please show these two, your suction head and your delivery head. Both are important. If you forget this, foot valve and strainer is also okay. These four are the most important parts which has to be mentioned. Now coming to different heads of turbine. So two heads you have already, gone through in the diagram itself. Your suction head, I'll just repeat again. The first two is your suction head, delivery head. Your suction head, again, it is a vertical height from the center of the pump, your center of the pump, to your water surface of your below tank, or the water surface from where the water is being lifted up. That is called as your suction head. The second is your delivery head. Your delivery head is again from the center of the pump to the water level. I'm not talking about the overhead tank, the water level in the overhead tank. Okay, so that is called as your delivery head. And the third term is static head. Your static head is a sum of suction head and your delivery head. So that is always same. If the water level is reducing below, it is increasing above. Your static head is generally same. The fourth and the most important term is a manometric head. It is the head against which the pump has to work. Okay, this is the energy, or this is a head available to your centrifugal pump. Well, I will say the notation also. Your suction head is generally represented as small hs, delivery head as small hd, static head is capital HS, and manometric head is capital HM. And this is the most important head which you'll be using for your problem, that is your manometric head. Now, there are three ways in which you can calculate your manometric head. So, first is head imparted by the impeller minus the losses. Okay. Now, the head imparted by the impeller, we will do in future, it is given by VW2U2 divided by G. Okay, minus the losses. And if you're not considering losses, it'll be VW2U2 by G. Okay, if losses are considered to be zero. This is one way of calculating your manometric head. The second way is by your Bernoulli's equation, total energy at outlet minus total energy at inlet. So at outlet, we are writing PO rho G plus VO square 2G plus ZO. Minus inlet PI rho G plus VI square by 2G plus ZI. So this is a total head at energy head, total energy head at outlet, total energy head at inlet. Now here your P by rho G can be replaced by your, at outlet we have your delivery pipe. It can be replaced by my delivery head. Your V naught can be replaced by your velocity in the delivery pipe. And ZO, I'll tell you later. So your PO by rho G is nothing but your delivery head. Your VO is nothing but the velocity in the delivery pipe. Okay, at the outlet, you have the delivery pipe. So velocity at the delivery pipe. Velocity, we can say, because there is no change of area, so the velocity remains constant. Now coming to the inlet side. Now at inlet, the PI by rho G can be replaced by HS, which is nothing but your suction head. VI can be replaced by VS, that is nothing but the velocity in suction pipe, and ZI. Now Z, remember, is a vertical height from the datum line. Now datum line, it depends on me from where I'm taken. So wherever the datum line is taken, so if I have this figure here, okay, so I have my inlet. Let this be my inlet. This is my outlet. So if I'm taking this as my datum line, so your distance is, this is my inlet distance and this is my outlet distance. Okay. So when you do problems, you will be a little more clear at that. And the third way is, it is given directly by the formula, which is equal to HD, delivery head, plus suction head, plus loss of head due to friction in suction pipe, plus loss of head due to friction in delivery pipe, plus VD square by 2G, where VD is the velocity in your delivery pipe. Now, these are the three formulas in which you're calculating your manometric head. And sometimes efficiency is given. So from there also, you can calculate your manometric head. So I thought I'll give you a small introduction to the velocity triangle also. Now, this is how your backward vane, okay, backward curve radial vanes looks like. This is from where the water is entering. The water is entering radially inside. Okay, so since it's entering radially inside, alpha angle is 90 degree and VW1 is equal to zero. And then it is coming out. Okay, so if I draw it here in a more simpler manner, so this is how your velocity triangle for the centrifugal pump will look like. Radially inside, your alpha is equal to 90 degree. VR1, we get theta. U1, V1, this here. And when it comes to outlet, we have VWF1. Remember, your absolute velocity is in this direction. Your relative velocity is in this direction. Two different directions. And your U1, U2 are given by, your N is the speed of the impeller. Your D1 as the diameter at inlet. D2 is the diameter at outlet. The work done, we will be doing in the next class. Thank you.